I am Paige.
I'm Aaliyah.
I'm Jing.
I'm Kyrie.
I'm Taylor.
And you're listening to Radio Heads.
Alright, happy March 6, 2013, everyone. Today you're going to be listening to the Radio Heads. And in today's show, we're going to be talking about five news stories today. One being the TSA allowing pocket knives and other weapons on transportation, the Miami Heat's win streak, a toddler being cured of HIV, gaming news, and a feature about the Fallout Boys and Imagine Dragons. So, our first feature will be presented by Aaliyah with the TSA allowing pocket knives and other weapons on transportation. Go ahead, Aaliyah.
Thank you, Jing. Well, since September 11, 2001, the terrorist attacks that occurred then, of course, and all airborne scares that happened afterwards, the TSA has become significantly stricter with their rules regarding air safety, prohibiting the carrying on of explosives, firearms, all the way to snow globes. In 2009, they even beefed up security with full body scanners in airports all over the U.S., and of course with the addition of TSA agent pat-downs. But as of yesterday, March 5th, the TSA has announced a decision to lift the regulations that they had employed since then. The regulations are really, the lift in regulations, of course, are really specific. Pocket knives, only 2.36 inches long and a half an inch wide, will be allowed to be carried on, no wider and no longer, as well as golf clubs, lacrosse sticks, hockey sticks, and pool sticks will be allowed on to carry on luggage. But box cutters and razor blades will still be prohibited, as they were the same weapons that the hijackers used on aboard the plane during 9/11. Passengers don't really seem to have a problem with it. It's more flight attendants. The flight attendants union called their decision poor and short-sighted in one of their statements, saying, "Continued prohibition of these items is an integral layer in making our aviation system secure and must remain in place. At the last line of defense in the cabin and key aviation partners, we believe that these proposed changes will further endanger the lives of all flight attendants and the passengers we work so hard to keep safe and secure." The TSA's decision will finally take effect on April 25th of this year.
All right, well, what are your guys' opinion on that? No opinions?
Oh, no, well, at first, I seem to, like, there's no real reason, I think, to be carrying a pocket knife aboard a plane.
You don't know, maybe you need something that requires a pocket knife, like opening an envelope. Okay, never mind. Alright, but, you know, there are other things that you can use a pocket knife for that, you know, it gets things you might need to do, and pocket knives right there is pretty convenient, so I don't know about that. And
but what if somebody decided to kill somebody
with a pocket knife?
I mean, like, pocket knives, they're still sharp blades.
I mean, you could kill somebody with a spoon if you sharpen it.
Which sounds crazy, but it's true.
A sharpened spoon killer. All right.
Pocket knives, they don't really seem necessary. This isn't Metal Gear Solid. There's no need to carry them, really.
Exactly.
It's just going to lead to problems.
All right. Well, at our second feature, we have Kyrie talking about the Miami Heat's win streak. So, yeah, Kyrie, go ahead.
Well, the Miami Heat haven't lost a single game since February 1st in Indiana, giving them a 15-game winning streak, which is their new franchise record. LeBron James and Dwayne Wade played a huge part in this amazing achievement. On the Heat's last victory, LeBron James scored 20 points and made 10 rebounds. Dwayne Wade alone scored 32 points with 10 assists. Now they put this streak on the line when they face off against another Florida team, the Orlando Magic, tonight at 7:30 Eastern Standard Time. Stay tuned for more updates.
So, who do you guys think are going to win tonight's game?
I'm rooting for the Heat.
we don't know. Like, I don't know if I'm going to jinx it, but you never know. The Florida Magic can always, you know, win. But and
well, they're both Florida. One is Miami, one is Orlando.
Alright, well, I'm going to be watching that game tonight, so, yeah, let's just, you know, root for our favorite. Okay, this game really cheesy. Okay. So with our third feature, we have Taylor with a toddler being cured of HIV. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so a mother who was HIV positive was expected to be giving birth to a child, but because doctors knew that the disease was most likely going to be transferred from the mother to the child, they tried controlling the disease by accidentally giving the infant high dosages of three different antiretroviral drugs. They don't know how the drugs were able to fully cure the child, but as of now, the two-year-old toddler is completely free of HIV, and she's the first to ever have been cured with the disease. And this could be the key to the door doctors have been trying to unlock for many years. The mother had actually not been diagnosed with HIV until after she gave birth to the child, so you could only imagine the devastation for the mother who had no clue there was a high risk of giving her child this incurable disease. However, the woman and her child had gotten really lucky to have found a cure for the first time, and the baby had been given the drugs for over 15 months, but then for some unknown reason, the mother stopped supplying the drugs to the infant. But she was still cured.
Alright. So, with, like, this new cure that, like, helped the toddler out, do you think that it'll help, like, other patients, like, worldwide?
Well, if they find... Because they think that it was a mistake, like, it wasn't on purpose that they tried to cure it.
But it was a good mistake.
It was a good mistake, but they're trying to figure out how to make it do it again, and it'll be hard to figure it out. Because they didn't even know that these drugs had any effect. They just thought that it was going to, help with symptoms for the kid, or, try and prevent it from being transmitted.
So the doctors were surprised when they realized that they, like, fully cured the toddler of HIV.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. All right. Well, with the fourth segment is going to be me talking about gaming. So the PS4 is officially announced during the February 20th, earlier this year, conference at Sony's conference. And they released a bunch of specialties and details about the console, but it turned out the only thing they didn't show was the console itself. So they showed, like, the controller, all the wires, but not the console itself. So I kind of got, you know, a little bit mad at that, because I have no idea where I'm going to put the console, because I haven't seen the actual console itself. I'm going to be talking about the hardware. The PS4 is going to be running on a single chip processor, which utilizes 8 86 to 64 AMD Jaguar computer cores, which is the next gen AMD Radeon based graphic engine, which powers it all the way. And if you guys have no idea what I just said, I'm just saying the hardware that the PS4 is going to run on is going to be similar to PC hardware. So it's going to be faster, it's going to run on more electricity, but at the risk of using more electricity, the graphics and the performance when playing it will be better. The memory will go up to 8GB and have a GDDR5 memory, which enables lightning fast performance when you're playing the game. The PlayStation 4 is also going to come out with a main accessory called the PS4i, which is like the Kinect camera, which is a highly sensitive camera that will recognize a player's voice and body movement when they're playing games. So I'm unsure about this, but the Sony producers say that it's going to play a big role when using the PlayStation 4, but in my opinion, I think it's just going to be used for interactive gaming. The controller is mainly just an upgraded PlayStation 3 controller, except with a touchpad in the middle, much like the PS Vita. It's official, and Sony producers say that the PS4 will be able to play 4K resolution videos, So, like, right now, up to this day, we have about 1080 to 190 resolution TVs, which play high-quality movies and shows and like that. But since no 4K movies or games have come out, or any videos, I don't know if that's going to work out on the PS4. At the conference, they also released many games such as Destiny, Diablo 3, Final Fantasy, Infamous, Killzone, and Watch Dogs, which when I saw them, I was amazed. The graphics were amazing. And the PS4 is estimated to come out this holiday 2013, so you know what you're gonna be putting on your wish list for Santa. And people are guessing the price to about being $450. And yep, that's it.
Personally, do you think that they should be making a Kinect for the PS4 or whatever?
Well, the Kinect can't. I don't know. I'm used to, like, not standing up and talking when I'm playing. I'm just used to sitting down and mashing buttons because, you know, interactive is boring and too much work. Like, I'm already using my hands to click buttons, so standing up is, you know, it's too much work. Alright, well, on our fifth feature, we're gonna have Paige talking about the Fall Out Boys and Imagine Dragon in her music segment.
Okay, so when Fall Out Boy went on a break in fall of 2009, there were rumors and a lot of confusion as to what the band's break actually meant. Were they gone forever or for a specific amount of time? Were the four members just taking a minute to breathe after releasing their recent album? Well, since the break in 2009, each member of the Fall Out Boys has branched out on its own, releasing solo albums and writing books. Wentz wastes no time starting a new project right after Fall Out Boy after the break, and forming an electronic duo with Black Cards artist Bebe Rexha in July 2010. Wentz and ex-wife Ashley Simpson are also divorced during the band's break, and he has recently been working on Grey, a new book reflecting his own rise to fame. Stump was the only member of the band to take a solo project on while Fall Out Boy was on break. He's released Soul Punk album in 2011, and he also married his longtime girlfriend in September 2012. The Fall Out Boy drummer ventured into rock after Fall Out Boy and went on a break drumming with many bands over the 3-year period, and he kept up his label and drummed for bands like Burning Empire and Enabler. But in October 2012, a new friend of the band tweeted that Fall Out Boy was in the process of making new music. The tweet went viral, within each member of the band was quick to deny any chance of the reunion, and in July, blogs started posting that Fall Out Boy was back and an announcement was coming soon. During the first week of February, DirecTV listings revealed that Fall Out Boy was scheduled to be a guest on Jimmy Kimmel's talk show, and all four band members were still trying to stay silent or denying rumors, keeping their secret until the official announcement hit the web. And then the second feature is on Imagine Dragons. And ever since their producer Alex the Kid got a hold of them several months back, Imagine Dragon has been soaring into the music scenes like pros. By September, the alternative rock band released their first album, Night Visions. Night Vision was so far sold to an estimate of 6 million, and since its debut, it's achieved gold status. Recently, they've been touring the United States for their sold-out tour that ends June 3rd in Phoenix. In a more recent week, while the band has been on tour, they've done really well. Their most recent successes was at their sold-out performance at the Eagles Ballroom. Nico Vega and Atlas Genius performed their opening act, which supposedly unique and kicked off a definite alternative feel. Viewers, mainly teens and college students, stated that the concert was refreshing and exhilarating, and their set consisted of 14 songs in a total of 85 minutes. Their entire vibe of the recent concert was such a success because it was so relaxed and open, and sources say that Reynolds, a member of the band, was rather humble between performances and was very down to earth. In fact, while prepping for the event, Reynolds accidentally hit one of the security guards with a drumstick. There was no injury and no evident damage, but he still made the crowd applaud, the entire team of security. So now we're going to listen to a few seconds of one of their hit songs, Radioactive, so you guys can get the feel.
Thank you, Paige. Well, that wraps up today's show by the Radiohead. Today's features, again, were the TSA allowing pocket knives and other weapons on transportation, the Miami Heat's win streak, a toddler being cured of HIV, gaming news regarding the PlayStation 4, and a feature with Paige about the Fallout Boys and Imagine Dragons.
Music.